This is Kupo Ching for Druk Asia, and with us today is Asha Kama, who is the founder of VAST in Bhutan, as well as being a very passionate artist who believes in how art can be used as a means of combating social ills. He is also a very keen volunteer with young people. Asha here also received the National Order of Merit Gold Medal from His Majesty, the King of Bhutan, in 2010. Is that right?
2011.
Asha, will you tell us a little bit about yourself?
My name is Kama Wangdi, but I'm known as Asha.
Mm-hmm.
Asha means uncle.
Mm-hmm.
Uncle title from the, you know, from the mother's side. So maternal uncle. This title I bought it as, because I've been hanging out with many young people, and so I bought this title. Now it's more like my pet name, my title. And I come from Dagana.
Yeah. But your VAST is in Thimphu, is it?
VAST is in Thimphu, yes. The main reason is to share what we have experienced for the last 30-40 years as an individual, as an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to, when we set it up, we really wanted to share what we have learned with the new younger generation. And that was the most important. Why we want to do that was, you know, in 80s, 90s, throughout the world, I think art as a curriculum in the schools has been dropped out.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the budget constraints and things like that have really cut out the art from the school curriculum. So I and few of us, we had the opportunity to actually get good tuitions and good encouragement from our teachers, but then our young, a lot in this generation, they didn't have that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
So we got together and we said, oh, why not we give that opportunity?
Mm-hmm.
So that's how VAST started. And over the last 15 years now, we have come across over 5,000 to 6,000 young children who are actually, who have an idea about what art can do, you know, the power of art.
So how did you become started as an artist?
I was, I think, destined to become an artist, you know, because my father, although he's a villager, and he had no idea about art and what is happening in the world, he had no idea about art, but then he was a very special craftsperson in the village. Although he's a farmer, he used his hand to cater to many artistic things like needed, required in the village. So when I was young, he needed an assistant. So he actually really dragged me into using my hand.
Mm-hmm.
By actually assisting him. So he happened to be the best arrow maker in the village, in that region. So I used to, when I was 9 years, seven
mm-hmm.
years old, I used to assist him.
Mm-hmm.
Because he needs an extra hand in apprentice sort of thing. So he makes me help him. Then he was very, again, hanging out with him. He makes arrows and give to the villager, young villagers, because archery is a national game, and
yes.
It's really, people are really passionate about this game.
Mm-hmm.
So all old people, young people, all are involved. So my father used to be very popular, because whenever we have these archery matches, we have this lines of people coming to get his arrows. And then that's how he never sold his arrows, but he gave away, and then they come and work for him.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how he actually connects with the people. So that is one very fortunate thing for me.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got into the public school,
mm-hmm.
again, I was very lucky, because the principal of the school, and there were a few other teachers who were very interested in actually sharing their art experiences with us. So that's why I had the opportunity to paint. Because my kindergarten teacher, she's from England, and she saw that we are very talented and interested in art, and she used to bring nice brush colors from England. So again, a very fortunate country. And then when I was in the high school, then my principal again was very interested in few of us who can use our hand in many ways. So he makes us to help the school in preparing all the teaching materials. And then again, he's really interested in that. So he brought in a teacher from Africa, Indian origin, but very good art teacher. So I happened to be with that art teacher for 2 years. So that's how I developed, and then I found, and my teachers, all to do with my teachers and my parents, they encouraged me into this line, because I wasn't really bright enough to follow the academic rules. I moved into
wisdom.
That sort of thing. And I was very fortunate about it.
It sounds that you were very blessed with people who brought art to you, not just as something to put on the wall, but also art as service.
Yes.
Art is something that is used practically, and art for the community.
Yeah.
You know what you were saying about people just wanting to be kind to each other.
Yes.
And that spirit you have brought through.
Yes.
So now,
and then now I'm some people say, oh, you have doing so many community things and things. I'm saying it's no. I'm just being back what I've got it, and then I think use art as that binding thing. It's very important to give and take, you receive, and then pass on that.
So how did you I noticed that you went to England at some point to receive. You had such diverse cultural influences in your art education. How did you come to go to England from Bhutan?
Again, it takes me back to my school days.
Mm-hmm.
My teacher really wanted me to say, you have opportunity to go into an art school.
Mm-hmm.
So I tried to get some sort of scholarship to study art.
Mm-hmm.
And then while I was trying, meanwhile my government said I should learn my own art, our own artistic culture in the country. So I was sent to an institution, an art institution, there we studied the traditional art,
Tampa
painting, all the 13 crafts.
Did you do the embroidery as well?
Yes. So again, that was a great opportunity, just fell on my lap.
Mm-hmm.
So while waiting for a scholarship, I got the opportunity to learn my own country's art. And then the scholarship scholarship never came through. So I became a traditional artist. And while I was working as a traditional artist, I chose Thanga painting as my medium. While working as a Thanga painter, suddenly the government again sent me to different organization where they need graphic artists. And then in those days, there were only few of us who had some educational background and some skill in the arts. I was sent as a graphic artist. And two, while I was working as a graphic artist, I got a scholarship to study graphic design. I tried for fine arts, but then the sponsor said graphic design is more suitable for us. So I was sent to study graphic design in England. So that's how I got to. Then I built my career as a designer.
Mm-hmm. And after England, you were there for a year, 2 years?
I worked for 2 years for the government as a designer. Then the designing was really good. A really drastic change. You have all this computer-aided designs, and you have all this software, illustrators. So designing wasn't, if you were not a computer kind of literate, designing wasn't that interesting thing. Then I was not very keen also to work as a designer. So I moved into painting. So that's where I started. Because that time I took an early retirement, and then I decided, I talked to some of my friends who had the same similar interest to share what they knew. So we started process and they can put it.
So while you were working as a graphic designer, you were working on formulating your art as what it is now that we can see at the exhibition.
That's true. I, over the years, I had the traditional background. Then I had the graphic design in my. I think there's a lot of design aspects in my work. That's why because of that, because of my 3 years experience in graphic design. Yeah, I tried to kind of fusing all this together with my likeness for texture. So I have not really given up graphic design. I have not really given up traditional art. One thing is I try to put them all together to do something new. That's why all my books have some aspects of those.
Oh yes. And the colors are they feel so vibrant. Do you use traditional pigment paint or you use a mixed media for your works?
I've worked with traditional paints, and then and I've worked with mixed media, and then I've worked with the oil and watercolor, the water based colors. These days I'm more into using mixed media and colors.
With this fusion of different aspects of influences and who you are now, what would you want your art to say to someone who's looking at something you produce, something you created? What message do you want to send to Bhutan or to the world?
Really messages, but I have not really mastered what I'm trying to say, but I'm just trying to kind of bring all the experiences together and then bring out something that I'm happy with, and I'm actually again in a stage where I'm with my experiences, because though I had the idea of becoming an artist, I had never really put myself into a situation where I created art, because I have been always like in anchors, you have to follow certain rules, and as a graphic designer, you provide something other people tell you to do. The graphic designers, you know, you can't just really do something that you want. All this thing we have to keep into consideration. Sometimes you become like a draft person. No, that line should be there, you know, and this color should be there.
But now you're free.
whoever gives the money, we have to follow. Now I'm free, and I'm not really like some kind of trying to change the perspective of people through my art, but I'm trying to keep them what I felt, and then it's keep the door open for them to like or not like, or you know, or express it the way they want. But I, for the last few years, I've been working as a full-time art teacher, and I've used a lot of my understanding of the philosophy behind the culture and the religion, and try to just go and try to bring together a few aspects of this cultural dimension together.
I'm sure you will see your influence in the next generation to come.
I think as in painter, as an artist, I think especially in a situation, the present situation, Bhutan, everything is happening, everything is changing, the whole perspective is changing, and then there are a lot of outside influences. I think we have the artisans have a big role to play in, and then try to preserve it, and then try to conserve it using art. And it's not necessarily that we have to kind of frozen freeze all the elements of art and then say that is ours. I think to let it go, let it remain as a culture, let it remain as a thing, we need to infuse a lot of influences, that I mean good influences, to move on, so then it becomes more alive than becoming a showcase.
So bringing this all you've learned from the past into your present and into the future.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very